Finally, we're at the end of Buffy the Vampire Slayer, and let me be productive because the final episodes are very mixed, but let me get to the high and good points, and then we'll get through some of the more troublesome aspects of the final episodes of Buffy the Vampire Slayer. So, on the good side, we still get a lot of good faith. I actually did appreciate them bringing in extra parts of the mythology, like the Shadow Men and the Scythe and the Guardians. But I think the way they were done was a little bizarre, but I did like this intriguing idea that there's much more to the Slayer mythology than we had thought. The additions there were really good. And of course, Caleb, played by Nathan, provides a lot of incredible extra energy near the end. And I thought the way that the first and Caleb interacted, I thought made a lot of sense. I'm sort of against the consensus. A lot of people thought it was very illogical that Caleb would work for the first, but I thought it was well done enough. And of course, I think the highlight was the Buffy and Spike relationship and the where they ended up. It's really kind of a question mark because we don't get the full story of what they think of one another, but I think that's fine. There's room for ambiguity, and I think I liked, for the most part, what they did with the characters because they didn't do a lot with them, I think, well in season 6, and I thought here it was fairly well done in terms of where they go back and forth between romance and friendship and kind of mutual respect. So I like that a lot. And again, I'm really against the consensus that Kennedy was a complete waste. I did like actually how she and Willow interacted. I think they wasted their time mostly, that's true, but I think, you know, towards the end it was very well done. So all those aspects were really, really good and enjoyable. But then we get to the bad part, which is the actual plan to destroy the first really has been torn apart. It really makes no sense whatsoever. If you did watch Angel, it makes a little bit more sense why Wolfram and Hart would help Buffy and use the amulet, but in terms of the sequencing of the plan, that really makes no sense. Angel coming back for no reason really also makes no sense. He could have just given the amulet. He didn't have to show up personally, and he sounds and looks differently, making a lot of jokes. It's understandable he'd still be jealous over Spike and things like that, but other things would be really, really out of character. So although I did like David Boreanaz doing this kind of final cameo for the series and sort of going back to the beginning of the show, his part in it was just strange. So it's great that he's there, but the actual dialogue and the actual moments were really puzzling. And again, what Buffy thought or was thinking is still not clear to us. It's sort of, I guess, that the potentials were going to distract the Turrican long enough for Spike to do what he needed to do, and Willow would empower them. But then why not just wait on top of the Hellmouth? Why not just wait for the amulet to work and then go down? Instead, they're going to go down before the amulet is activated. That really made no sense. How did Willow know these powers were going to work? Is she connected to the Scythe? They don't really explain that. Is it the Scythe itself can give the Slayers all these powers? Is it just because it's connected to the Slayers and potentials just vaguely? So again, a lot really doesn't make sense. I did like, though, how Willow did turn to the light because they were giving a lot of hints. She would be on the dark side, so I think that was well done. But again, you kind of keep asking questions like how or why Kennedy was just running through and none of the Bringers or Turrican stopped her. They just didn't care. Where are they exactly? How are they getting on top? The strength of the Turrican versus the potentials. Again, they could have just explained things a little bit better. Maybe just the way Willow empowered them is going to give them an extra boost. So they have like super Buffy powers. But them being able to take on the Turrican so easily or just throw them off just really did not make a lot of sense. Why they planned the plan the way they do, just didn't seem to be motivated. It just seems like Buffy heard the first, and the first said something, and that gave her the idea. But what the first said doesn't really tie into the plan. So it's just, I mean, I get the whole point of the speech is that men wrote these rules. We're going to break the rules. We're going to have this female empowerment theme. That's fine. But again, the way Joss visualized it, it just really doesn't add up. It didn't make a whole lot of sense. And it's not as really coherent as you might think. I mean, I'm seeing this little girl with a baseball bat. What's that a metaphor for? I'm still like, life is like baseball? I'm like, what exactly is the connection of the image to the story? Parts of it made sense of the girl standing up to the abuser, but other parts of it were just like, okay, what exactly is this? How is this connected? It's just happening. And it's a real shame too, because Joss did a lot with season 5, because season 5 was very wobbly and all over the place. But the final episode really crystallized a lot of things. Yes, it went through these insane retcons, which were really ridiculous, but I still think they pulled it off, and it did make sense at the end of the day in terms of why Glory had to be destroyed and how Buffy killed herself and why she did it. But here, it just things seem to just happen. Again, it's very powerful the way Willow and Spike are technically working to save the world. But then it just, you think about it, like, well, Spike and Willow could have just gone alone and just the two of them could have just destroyed the first and the Turrican and that's it. Really, everyone else was kind of needless. Was it a point to distract the Turrican and the first? I don't know. It's just a lot of questions at the end of the day. I mean, it doesn't take away from the final episodes. I do think they're above average, but you were kind of hoping for kind of transcendental excellence at the end, something really incredible and spectacular. And there are some great moments, but really, it's just a lot of question marks like, huh? What? Why? How? But again, it's Buffy. You get it. It's about her triumph and her winning. And it is still very well shot. And the music especially is insane. And so I would recommend the final episode just because the music itself was really powerful in the final sequences. But does it make a lick of sense? Yeah, probably not. Does it really hang together as a strong story? No. Angel finished off much, much stronger comparatively. And I know Joss said he wanted one more episode, but the network denied him that. And that's, you know, something you should take into account. But then that just shows that the whole season was not constructed well enough. And they wasted a lot of our time. And they could have just done a better job structuring everything. But it's an above average finale. But again, with Buffy, you were just hoping for something even better than that. And that's just not what we get. From that stance, yeah, it's very mixed ending, but still very powerful. And I do highly recommend seeing it because there's enough there that it's really well worth seeing again for many times. But yeah, the problems do stand out in very sharp relief, unfortunately. All right, this has been the non-spoiler ending to Buffy the Vampire Slayer. We will be getting into other aspects of Buffy soon enough. Thanks for listening. Please have a good day.